The province of Cebu is set to be placed under enhanced community quarantine starting March 27. Let's talk to Cebu Governor Gwen Garcia on what measures the local government will roll out and how it's preparing to implement those. Good morning, Governor, and thank you for joining us.
Good morning, Christian.
Okay, good morning. I understand you have already issued an executive order placing the entire Cebu province under an enhanced community quarantine. Is that correct?
That's right. I signed the executive order last night.
Okay. So what will be the difference now that the entire province is under an enhanced community quarantine? The do's and don'ts.
Well, we will be on a graduated scale. Merong mangyayari na hindi na pwede. Like, for example, I signed that executive order last night so that in 24 hours or effective 12.01 on the 27th of March, we will no longer be accepting passengers coming in from international flights that continue to arrive at our Mactan Cebu International Airport. And then this afternoon, I'll be meeting with all of our mayors in the 44 towns and 7 cities of Cebu, including mayors also from Lapu-Lapu and Cebu City, in order to agree on the several preventive measures that we'll be instituting that will mean maraming restrictions on the movement of people in each of the LGUs.
Like what restrictions, Governor? Let's try to be more particular here. What can a resident do and do not do under this enhanced community quarantine?
Kasi under the enhanced community quarantine, talaga everybody has to stay in their houses na eh.
Okay, so kailan lang sila pwedeng lumabas po, Governor? Kailan lang po pwedeng lumabas yung mga residente ng Cebu during this enhanced community quarantine?
Well, that will only be para bumili ng pagkain, essential supplies. Yun lang. We will have to be already identifying yung persons na bibigyan ng quarantine pass na pwede lumabas. Of course, there will also be people that will need to go out for medical services or need to go and work for essential services. So all of these will be agreed upon and identified.
How about public transport within the province? Will that also be suspended?
We are looking at that. Kasi pag confined na kayo in the houses, then there will be no longer need for any public transport. And kung ano man yung mga essential services na kailangan magpapatuloy, then we will need to ensure that the companies involved will have to be able to provide transportation services to the employees.
So, for example, there is a grocery store owner and his or her employees need to come to work. That particular person, that owner, that employer, should be the one to provide transportation for the workers?
Yes, precisely.
Pero the provincial government and the city governments, they won't be providing any special transportation for these workers, also the healthcare workers. Walang ganun?
Patuloy din yan. Kasi there are also mga frontline workers, including mga even barangay health workers, yung mga barangay tanod, yung mga kailangan pumunta ng mga rural health units.
Okay.
Now, this will have to be provided ng local government unit.
Okay. Now, will there also be curfews imposed in different parts of the province? Because in some areas in the Philippines, despite the community quarantine, certain local governments also went on to impose curfews.
Ang ginawa natin sa Cebu, Christian, nagiging gradual na imposition of restrictions. Little by little, we have already been imposing mga restrictions on the movement of our constituents. Unang-una, nagkaroon na tayo ng curfew. We impose curfew at 10 o'clock in the evening hanggang 5 in the morning.
Mm-hmm.
And then, I think it was last week, that we imposed also a 24-hour curfew na on all persons 65 years old and above, as well as all students from preschool, daycare, elementary, high school, college, and postgraduate unemployed students.
Governor, what happens?
Certainly, we will also be imposing curfew.
What happens to the violators? Let's say you caught someone violating the curfew.
Talagang they will be accosted by our PNP, and they are subjected to a lecture, and on a case-to-case basis, they are held for some hours.
Okay. Now, speaking of violators, there was this news about a rapper from Cebu actually apologizing to you. This was aired on Facebook, right? What happened there?
Kasi when we imposed the curfew on students, naglagay sa Facebook na nagkaroon pa rin daw sila ng rap battle march, at sinabi pa na, he was cursing kami lahat na nag-i-impose ng curfew. Sinasabi niya na yung coronavirus daw hindi tumatalag sa kanila kasi malalakas sila. Yan, that is only for the week. And he was actually parang dinidare niya kami.
So what did you do? So, did you summon him?
Well, first of all, kasi nagkakaroon tayo daily ng live interview and this has become like a daily ano rin na parang information interview ng lahat, ng marami. And they look forward to it. I presented his Facebook post at sinasabi ko na hindi pwede ito. You cannot just flaunt, you know, your misdeeds before government. So he eventually surrendered, and I presented him kasi pumunta sa akin. He apologized. I accepted his apology, but I still insisted na charges will be filed.
And what are the charges?
Unang-una, may provincial ordinance sa kami kasi rito, Christian. Yung mga executive orders ko are promptly supported by a provincial ordinance. Kaya, for example, yung executive order ko imposing the curfew is supported by a provincial ordinance, and therefore may penal clause yon. So, a violation would mean a penalty of 5,000 or a 1-year imprisonment or both. Kaya, ayun. Due process, syempre, pero we filed our complaint or the charge before the prosecutor.
Ah, nag-file na po kayo ng kaso?
Opo.
Okay. So what exactly was the violation? For violating the curfew?
Yes.
Okay. Now, let's move to another controversy, because you're also being criticized online for your statement in response to a school paper criticizing the measures implemented by the provincial government. Was this a response that you felt needed to be given out? Because you're being criticized by the College Editors Guild of the Philippines because you replied to one editorial coming from a school paper titled Today's Carolinian. The title of the editorial, I think, was "A Governor is Not Above the Constitution."
Well, that's a grossly uninformed piece of writing, and that's only by a paper and duly supported by the Cebu Editors Guild. I invited, in fact, the writer para he could explain na ito yung ginagawa natin. I think they have become incensed by the measures that we are now taking in order to protect everyone against the spread of the coronavirus. Medyo, tawagin na lang natin uninformed. Hindi ko nasasabihin na talagang walang alam. So sabi ko, punta ka sa office ko para pwede ka, we can explain what this is all about and how government is moving to protect your own life.
Hindi natuloy yung meeting. Pero what were these quote lies that you were talking about? What did the editorial get wrong?
What?
Lies. Ano yung mga kasinungalingan na sinabi nung school paper?
I did not say kasinungalingan. I said uninformed.
Okay, I misheard your term kanina, yung lies.
Unang-una na objection niya na ano daw. Kasi meron tayong ginawang, meron tayong 28 na special unit in order to complement the cyber crime unit, cyber libel unit of the PNP. Na itong lahat ng mga posts online, no, or sa social media, which specifically spread fake news and specifically boast or brag about breaking existing ordinances or executive orders, talagang they will have to account for their actions. Yun naman ibig sabihin ko.
Oh, pero what were the violations committed?
Kasi naman one paper reported it. Ito yung Cebu Daily News, a digital paper, kasi digital, kasi wala na silang
print.
Ano yan? Circulation. Siguro hindi na bumibenta sa ano na lang, digital na lang. Masyadong ano naman, slanted yung pagka-report. Yung inilagay naman doon na itong unit na na-create ng provincial government is only to run after those that would post negative comments. Well, this young boy or little boy that wrote that editorial immediately reacted.
Yeah, pero Governor, that's why. Governor, excuse me.
Came up with a piece entitled "The Governor Cannot Be Above the Constitution" and went on to proceed as though the Constitution were being violated. So sabi ko, welcome to my office, see me para we can explain to you what exactly we are doing here to protect lives, especially in the great crisis that we are now facing against the COVID-19.
Governor, just to clarify. Governor, excuse
me. Hindi naman nagpakita.
Governor, but I need to clarify this. Is there a crackdown against fake news in your province? And if there's such a crackdown, there's a crackdown, right?
We do what we can against fake news kasi this causes undue alarm and panic amongst the people that are already alarmed and panicked against the COVID-19. Kaya we have warned everyone na they will be dealt with accordingly when they spread fake news.
What do you mean by they will be dealt with accordingly?
There is already an existing provincial ordinance that also penalizes those that spread fake news.
But who is the arbiter on whether an information is fake news? And how do you distinguish between legitimate criticism of the measures being implemented by the government and those that are purely fake?
Well, that is when due process comes in, Christian. Kaya fake news is something like someone posting na meron ng namatay na 10 tao, cremate in a certain cosmopolitan parlor, at they know na totoo yon when in fact that is not true. But of course, hindi naman yan kaagad-agad sinasabi natin na you're guilty. We filed the appropriate charges before the prosecutor. This prosecutor, of course, will have to determine whether, in fact, there's a case against these people. And then, patuloy tayo in court.
But are they still free to, let's say, criticize the local government, the provincial government, about something that they're not happy about?
Kaya nga, sana yung sumulat ng editorial na yon was brave enough to support his views in person as he was as he displayed so much braggadocio in his editorial. Kasi we would have explained na nagkakamali siya, led on by that matawag natin inaccurate reporting of Cebu Daily News. Because he was led to believe na kahit i-criticize lang, or they had a different view, or they did not agree with a particular move of government, ayun ay fake news na. And that would be tantamount already to being charged by the local government or by the provincial government. Yun ang pagkakaintindi niya. Pati nga yung question mo ngayon, yun din pagkakaintindi mo. Sana kung nagpakita siya, we would have shown him and accurately explained what this is all about.
No, so but
the crisis that we are facing.
That's why I'm clarifying things with you, Governor, because you yourself said that there is a crackdown in Cebu province regarding against fake news. But again, my question is, how do you distinguish between fake news and legitimate complaints or dissent about certain measures that the provincial government or the other local governments are implementing? Because some people might think that...
There's the difference. Fake is fake. And a legitimate complaint is a legitimate complaint. And that is where due process comes in. Pag sinabi mong meron ng namatay na sampo, primate in a cosmopolitan parlor, eh, kung wala naman, talagang that's fake.
Yeah, that is indeed fake.
But if you are legitimately complaining, like saying, eh, ito, may abuso dito, inabuso kami, we were just in the house, and we were apprehended by the police, ganito, ganira. Kaya nga, kailangan may due process, hindi ba? Hindi ka naman kaagad ipipenalize because the rule of law still continues.
Yeah, and also interestingly, the country itself has no law yet against fake news, yet you decided to crack down on fake news. Understandably.
There's the cyber crime law.
But it's not against fake news.
As I told you, there's a provincial ordinance. Okay? There's a provincial ordinance that already states that any false information will carry a penalty of 5,000 pesos or 1 year imprisonment or both. Pumasa na kami ng provincial ordinance.
Okay. On that note, thank you very much, Governor Gwen Garcia, for joining us this morning. Thank you.
You're welcome.